So lastly, to round up lecture 6, we are going to take a look at a code example, and we will be using Scikit-Learn, so it will be relatively simple. In practice, I always recommend using Scikit-Learn when you work on a real-world machine learning project, because Scikit-Learn is very relatively fast, very efficiently implemented, and kind of robust, because the developers spend a lot of time and a lot of years to improve the code base, so it's relatively robust and relatively free from bugs compared to an implementation that we would do ourselves. However, in the homework, you will be implementing a decision tree by yourself, a CART decision tree, to help your understanding of how that works, basically. But here, we are just focusing on the Scikit-Learn one. Okay, so let's get started with this notebook. So first I'm loading, again, the watermark package, which I just like to do so I can see what versions I'm currently using. And also for you, if in case something doesn't work when you run the code, you can see maybe that's because you have an old version of some of the software being used here. Okay, so first we start by using or loading the iris dataset. We are using the iris dataset so that we don't have to spend time explaining a new dataset, and we can focus more on the code here and how the code works rather than the dataset. So we can skip discussions of the dataset because the iris dataset you have seen a lot of times before now. And one thing to note here though is that we are using only two features, and that is for two purposes. It's so that we can visualize a decision region plot, like just for educational purposes, but then also when we plot the decision tree, it will not be a very complicated tree and will be easier to look at. So we will be plotting a decision region plot and also a decision tree plot. Okay, so let's load the data set. So the features into X, the labels into Y. And just as a sanity check, the class labels are 0, 1, and 2, where 0 is Iris Setosa, 1 is Iris Virginica, and 0 is Setosa, 1 is Versicolor, and 2 is Virginica. So we have three class labels, and we split the data set into a training and a test set. So in this notebook, we won't be doing any tuning. So you could technically tune this decision tree by using, for example, grid search, like I explained in the Scikit-Learn lectures in lecture 5. But in this notebook, just for simplicity, we won't be doing that. So also because we won't be doing any tuning, we also don't need a validation set. We are just training the decision tree on the training set and then evaluating it one time on the test set. So 30% of the data will be used for testing, and we will do a stratified split, which will then consequently mean that the proportion of class labels is the same in the training and the test set. So let's do this, and then just for sanity checking, we can see the original data set had 150 data points, 50 from each class, and then in the training set we have 35 data points from each class, and then in the test set we have 15 examples for each class. So that's because of the stratification, that they are all uniform, they all match the same distribution here. Now we are starting with the plot decision regions. So recall the Scikit-Learn implementation is for an estimator that we initialize the estimator first. Here we can choose the hyperparameters or settings. So we use as the criterion the entropy. That's for the information gain. We do some pre-pruning, so we set the maximum depth to 2. And this is just also for education purposes. We can change it around and see how it changes the plot decision regions, the plot here. And the random state, I forgot what they use the random state for. I think it could be related to finding out or finding the bins for, if you have a continuous feature, you have to find a threshold. And I think this is related to finding the threshold. So there could be some slight randomness, but technically a decision tree classifier doesn't have a randomness. I forgot what the random state is currently used for in the decision tree, but we can maybe look at this later on Piazza and discuss this. Okay, so we fit the tree and then we plot the decision regions. Let's take a look. So this is my decision region plot for the decision tree. And we can see that with two splits, it separates the data nicely. Let's see if we remove this hyperparameter, or let's say set that to a higher number. We can actually set none, and then this is the default setting, then it won't have a limit. So you can see it does more complicated split. Here are more, I think, three more splits. So I don't know. But so the decision boundary becomes a little bit more complicated here, and this may be fitting the training data better, but then it could be more likely to overfit the training data. So actually the performance on the test set may not be improving due to that. But that would be something you would have to find out with a validation set. Okay, let's go back to two. So yeah, that's how the decision tree would look like. The boundaries perpendicular to the axes. Just to take a look at the other options. So so you can also, by default it uses actually Gini, so you can change between Gini or entropy. The splitter is how it determines the splits, the max depth and so forth. It requires a minimum of two training examples per split. Makes sense, right? Because we can't split a node on one training example, but we can set this to a higher number. So we can say, for example, 5, and then it won't split any nodes that have 1, 2, 3, or 4 examples at a node, which is kind of, having the same effect almost as setting the minimum samples per leaf. It's kind of very similar. Okay, these are the default parameters. Let's maybe take a look at the descriptions here. So there's only Gini and entropy here. By the way, if you want to use the decision tree regressor, there is a different class, I think, if I recall correctly. You have to import it as decision tree regressor. If you want to use, this is the right one, if you want to use it for regression analysis. So here are different types of splitters. I think this is where the randomness comes in. So random split, this is something that is used in a, if I recall correctly, in an extra trees classifier. So we will talk about this very, very briefly in the next lecture when we talk about ensemble methods. So this is kind of a special case of a random forest where there will be a random split, if I recall correctly, but I'm not exactly sure. I think I have to double check. I think extra trees just chooses a random feature at each node. We will have to double check that. And then all these different parameters, for example, the minimum number of examples required to split the internal node, like I said, and then this one. This is a little bit, this is related to this one, but it's a little bit different, right? Because here we say what the minimum number it is to split, but then it could, for example, result in splitting 5 into 4 and 1. So we have one example at one node, for example. However, this one would determine the minimum examples at the final leaf node. So it's a little bit different, but overall it has a very similar effect. It's different though. But there are lots of hyperparameters that you can choose and play with. And here we can even set a minimum impurity decrease. So preventing the tree to split certain nodes if they don't result in a minimum increase. This is kind of related to a chi-square test where you have a minimum increase, but you don't do a test, you just set the number here. So you can maybe read about this more. I'll read more about this later. We will also talk about feature importances in the next lecture. It's kind of related also to random forests, but you can compute feature importances for trees and random forests, which we will revisit in the next lecture. All right, so let's just continue. I was just showing you how you can implement a decision tree using Scikit-Learn. Now let's visualize the decision tree. So in order to visualize the decision tree, there are two methods. One is the traditional method using a library called GraphViz. It's like for visualizing graphs, and the graphs are visualized for so-called dot files. And the dot file format is like a GraphViz thing as far as I know. And there's a PyDotPlus library that can pass these dot files. So you kind of need both the Pilot Plus library and the Graphis library, as I remember correctly. So you can install both with Conda. You can actually also go to the Graphis website and install it from there by downloading it. But I find it easier just to install it everything via Conda. So Graphis, I think, is also a standalone tool for Mac and Windows and Linux. But this one will install it directly, so you don't have to download the standalone version. And then once you have done that, so you can then use this export Graphis function, which will turn a decision tree. So let me go back or up here. Let me delete that so it's easier to scroll. So we have a tree that we already fit to the training data, and now we want to visualize it. So this graph from dot dot, the export graph function will plot the fitted decision tree. And then we have some settings here about whether the nodes should be colored, have rounded edges, whether we want to use the actual class names instead of having just 0, 1, and 2. So to make this a little bit more readable, if, for example, you give a presentation or something, it's more readable to have the actual class names rather than these integer names. And then the same thing for the features. So instead of having x0 and x1, we have then petal length and petal width. Actually, note in the Iris dataset, these are the features 2 and 3 because we selected them. But then when we have our dataset x here, it's the first feature and the second feature, so x0 and x1. So it would show x0 and x1 if we don't choose the names explicitly. And then we can also choose whether we want to write this to a file. So you can actually write this to a dot file on your hard drive and then open it in GraphViz. But instead of doing that, instead of writing this file, a dot file, let's say tree dot dot, and then opening it with GraphViz, you don't actually need to do that. The dot data will be written to a variable in Python, and then you can do or use the function graph from dot data, which is then depending on this PyDotPlus library. And this will read the dot data and make then the plot. So let's do this. So this will create a visualization in PNG format. You can also do a PDF. Personally, I prefer PDF if I give a presentation or write a report in LaTeX because it has a higher resolution. That is what I explained to you when we talked about Matplotlib in lecture 4. However, we can't display PDF files in a Jupyter notebook. So in this case, this is why I'm using a PNG file. So and then in order to load the PNG file into Jupyter notebook, we can use the IPython display submodule from the IPython tool. I don't know why I made it a markdown file, it should be a code file. And then we can import the image, I think it's an image class from IPython display, and this will just load a PNG file. You can use that for any PNG file. Actually, we could also technically use markdown. So in markdown, we can load it like this. So it would be the same thing. I think this should work. No, for some reason it doesn't. Oops. Yeah. This would work, or we can just do it like this. And this is a code solution. The other one would be just a markdown solution. So this is how our decision tree looks like. So we can see first it's split on the petal width at smaller or equal 0.75. So if we scroll up again, petal width, it's this one. So here this is our first split. Right? Makes sense. And we start with 105 examples, uniform class distribution, so the entropy would be maximum for these for three class problem here. And here it shows in the last line the dominant class, the class that's most frequent. However, here it's a tie, and if anywhere is a tie in Scikit-Learn, it's usually choosing the first value, which is Setosa. Okay, and if it's smaller than 0.75, then go left. So here we end up with Setosa flowers, and you can see it's a pure node now. Entropy is 0. All 35 examples are from class 0. So again, so this value array or list stands for the class name. It's corresponding to what we had here. So class label 0, 1, and 2. Here are the actual counts for these class labels. So we have 35, 0, and 0. So it's a pure node, and let's see if that makes sense. So if we split along this axis, we can see all the Setosa flowers. All the Setosa flowers here are to the right. So square is Setosa. So yeah, this is a pure node. If we split smaller than 0.75, everything below here will be a Setosa flower. So we are done with the Setosa flower. Next, we have to split between Versicolor and Virginica. So we have to make this split here, which is based on the petal length. So let's go here. We can see if the petal length is smaller than 4.75. So we go here, it's 4.75. Then it should be the triangle, the Setosa, Versicolor. And then if it's greater than 4.75, it's then the Virginica, the green ones here. So here we still have a very relatively high entropy because we have a mix between those classes here. And then when we split, we have now a pure node here and almost pure node here. So the entropy is still not zero, but it's actually pretty good. We have 5 from one class and 35 from the other class. That's actually not too bad. And this is very good here. So we could split this one further. We could do that by setting the max depth to none, but then we will end up with a much deeper tree here, right? Oops, it's actually a pretty deep tree. Didn't look like that many here, but it seems to be a lot of splitting going on here. So this is, you can see, this is way less interpretable if you tell someone what's the difference between a Setosa, Versicolor, and a Virginica flower. How would you classify them? I mean, how would a decision tree classify them? That makes almost no error. I would say a tree like that is pretty interpretable. You can say flowers that are very small in petal width are almost always Setosa flowers, and larger flowers, you have to look at the petal length. So here you look at the petal width. If it's small, you know it's a Setosa. If it's a larger petal width, you look at the petal length. And if it's small, you know it's almost always a Versicolor flower. And otherwise, it's a Virginica flower. There may be a chance that you make a mistake. So there are some flowers that are very similar. But overall, you get the idea. It's something that's easy to explain to someone. Okay, this is how you make a decision tree in Scikit-Learn and how you make this visualization. However, some people, depending on the computer, have problems with these two libraries, so it's sometimes not easy to install them for some reason. So in that way, there is another function. It's I made a separate notebook so to show you that I'm actually not importing GraphWiz and that it works entirely without it. So all the code here is duplicated, so nothing new happens. I just made a new notebook, so you can see I'm actually not importing anything here. So, and then this plot tree function in behind the hood, this is importing matplotlib, the plotting library, which we already used here. So it's using that one. And this is based just on matplotlib, and it also can make the plot. It doesn't look as pretty. I mean, it still looks good and you can see everything, but it doesn't look as pretty as this one because it doesn't have the rounded edges and the font is a little bit different. The arrows are not quite as pretty, but I think this is pretty fine. And if this works for you, this is great. Then I would use that one. It's just based on matplotlib. It's just computationally simpler. Let me see if I can make it a bit nicer. No, not really, but it's still very good. So I recommend this one if you have problems with GraphWiz. So it's just a matplotlib-based function. Okay, and this is it for decision trees. In the homework, you will be implementing a decision tree by yourself.